Hello everyone, welcome to today's webinar. I'm Alexandra Taylor, Assistant Editor at CNEN, and I will be moderating today's event. This webinar is titled Evaluation of Packaging Safety, Migrants Characterization Using Advanced Analytical Tools, and it's being sponsored by Waters. CNEN works with sponsors to identify topics of interest and value to CNEN's audience and consistent with CNEN's mission to provide news and analysis of the chemistry enterprise in a timely, accurate, and balanced fashion. During the webinar, you can adjust the size of the slides on your screen by grabbing the lower right corner with your mouse. If you need technical assistance, please look at the Help widget at the bottom of the screen or type your query into the Q&A box. If you are disconnected during the webcast, please log in again according to the instructions you received earlier. You're encouraged to contribute to the success of this webinar by asking questions at any time during the presentation through the Q&A box on your screen. The questions will be answered at the end of your presentation, and as your moderator, I will be posing as many as time permits. Please note that CNEN does not endorse any company, products, or services that may be mentioned in the webinars, and that each webinar will be archived at CNEN online after the live webcast. The presentation today is being sponsored by Waters. Waters aims to create business advantages for laboratory-dependent organizations by delivering practical and sustainable scientific innovation to enable significant advancement in healthcare delivery, environmental management, food safety, and water quality. During the presentation, we will hear from Dr. Sarah Dubail, who is a senior regulatory analyst with the Sherwin-Williams Company Packaging Coatings Division. Before that, she was the manager of the European lab Valspar, where she was in charge of analyzing migration from packaging coatings and providing analytical data for risk assessments. Sarah has extensive knowledge of food contact materials regulations and the analytical methods for the determination of FCM and NIAS migration. I will now hand over to Sarah.
Hello everyone, thank you for the introduction, and I first want to thank Waters for the invitation to present this webinar. So all what I will present today will be only my views or the views of my company, Sherwin-Williams, formerly Valspar, and we are a producer of coatings, including for metal food packaging. So I will talk today about an introduction on how, as Sherwin-Williams, we evaluate safety of metal food contact packaging, and this goes through the analysis of migrants and characterization using advanced analytical tools. So the agenda for today's webinar is first, short review of why canned food, what are the benefits of metal can packaging, then why coatings, what is a coating and what it is used for. Then I will give an overview of the food contact regulations and requirements in force in especially in Europe and in the US, and detail our approach to meet the requirements coming from regulators, but also coming from the supply chain, the ultimate goal being to ensure consumer safety. For that, Sherwin-Williams, formerly Valspar Corporation, has implemented a process called Safety by Design. I will get a few words on this, and then I will start talking about analytical chemistry. To get a new substance approved for direct food contact, we need to go in the lab and to generate scientific data. So I'll explain how we approach the challenge to detect and identify unknowns and what we do to obtain the necessary information to get a new substance approved. Among the information which are required, migration data are needed, and that implies the use of advanced analytical techniques. As examples, I will go through two real case studies that we carried out on new substance envisaged to use for food contact. So why canned food? So metal packaging have broad advantage. So first, metal cans provide the best protection for food and beverages. The metal is durable and combined with a good airtight seal, it locks in the product's quality and locks out germs, air, light, and any other elements which could degrade the product quality and threaten consumer health. The canning process itself kills off bacteria and other harmful agents, ensuring safe and nutritious food for the consumer. Cans also minimize spoilage and product waste. Nearly half of all food grown in the US, for example, goes to waste, and food waste also poses significant environmental problems in addition to economical problems. So it's an issue really for consumers, producers, retailers, and for the entire society. So metal cans helps to minimize food waste by providing the longest shelf life of any package. So now, why do we need packaging coatings? So first, the coating protects the product from the package and the package from the product. It also helps to release the food from the container. It is also useful to help to fabricate the cans, and it has a decoration and advertising function, especially for the external coatings and inks. Decoration ensures brand recognition, advertising, and marketing. Many characteristics of the coatings contribute to their value, and through them to the value of the metal cans and packed food. And for us at Sherwin-Williams, global regulatory approvals, food safety, brand protection, non-DPA, are some ways to differentiate and to bring added value to the coatings intended to be used in contact with food. To develop such products requires highly technical and scientific skills, including a deep knowledge in various fields as organic chemistry, polymers, formulation, analytical chemistry, and toxicology. So now we will see in more details what are the ingredients of a coating. So it contains several raw materials. The coating is a layer of organic material applied to any substrate for the purpose of protection, fabrication, and hot decoration. Main ingredients are the resins, either main resins or cross-linking resins. They provide most of the coating properties, such as corrosion resistance, flexibility, hardness. And the choice of a resin is a series of formulation compromise, balancing chemical resistance and flexibility. The resin influences the regulatory status of the final coating. And usually, the main resin gives its name to the coating, like epoxy, polyester, acrylic, phenolic, vinylic. The solvents are the carrier for the resin. They must be compatible with the resin, and they will influence viscosity and solid, and at the end, the application properties. The coatings are then cured. The solvents will be removed from the final film. The coating can be functional or decorative, or both. Therefore, it can be clear, dyed, or pigmented. And pigments will add color to the coatings. The most common one is TiO2. Then additives. Additives are chemicals of various nature. They are added to enhance coating features like the catalyst or the lubricant, or they provide more robust application like the defoamers. So then what is a resin? A resin is a low molecular weight polymer. Resin is an old terminology. Originally, it was used to refer to resinous materials exuding from trees. So nowadays, it usually means low molecular weight polymer. So resins or polymers are made up from smaller monomer units, which will be combined together to form the final polymer or resin. There are two types of resins, either thermosets, which are usually consist in the core business coatings. They are filmed by chemical reaction. Their molecular weight will be usually pretty low, between 1,500 to 10,000 daltons, and their property is to become permanently hard and rigid when heated. The thermoplastic resins are capable of film formation by evaporation of solvents, for example PVC. The molecular weight is a lot higher, can be up to 150,000 daltons, even more, and they are substances that become soft and pliable when heated, or they can stay adhesive. And the synthesis mode of resin can be of two kinds, either polyadhesion without any loss during polymerization, or polycondensation, which consists in chemical reaction with some loss like water. So epoxy are very well-known chemistries. They have excellent corrosion resistance, very good pack performance. They have been used extensively in food contact coatings for over 40 years. They can be used even with very aggressive food. They are made by stepwise polyadhesion, the chemical reaction taking place being phenol plus epoxy group giving an ether bond. So they are historically made from badge and bisphenol A, and epoxy resins have hydroxyl functionality which will allow the epoxy resin to cross-link with either aminoplast or phenoplast. Another chemistry of resins is polyester. Polyester resins are well adapted to low to medium aggressivity foodstuff. They have lower corrosion resistance than epoxy for acidic or aggressive foods on a general basis. They can be either very rigid or very flexible depending on the crosslinker used, or also depending on the monomer used to make them. The waterborne coatings need acid functionality for water dispersibility after neutralizing. And some typical polyols are neopentyl glycol, 2-methylol propan, ethylene glycol. Some typical polyacids are terephthalic acid, isophthalic acid, 2-melitic anhydride, adipic acid. So they are made by polycondensation, alcohol plus acid, giving an ester plus water. So alkyd resins are a subfamily of polyesters, vegetable oils being used instead of the acids. In this case, the molecular weight are lower, the fatty acids from the vegetable oil acting as chain stopper. Then other families are acrylic resins, which have good appearance properties. They preserve color and gloss. They are made by polyadhesion and are often of very high molecular weight. When dispersed into water, they take the name of latex. They are made from a wide range of potential starting monomers, usually based on acrylate or metacrylate structure, or containing as well styrene. And then PVC, polyvinyl chloride, is a thermoplastic polymer prepared from vinyl chloride monomer. The major issue with PVC is the hydrochlorination with HCl being generated and potentially engendering discoloration. Therefore, HCl scavengers are often added to the formulation. And in practice, PVC resins can, for can coatings can contain other reactive comonomers. Coatings made from PVC are named organosols. They have good flexibility and are often applied as a second layer, the first layer being epoxy phenolic or polyester. So in order to achieve film formation, most resin systems need the addition of a crosslinker. The combination of the crosslinker and resin will give the coatings the resistance properties. During cure, the crosslinker and the polymer will react together and create a durable coating film. Main crosslinker chemistries are phenoplast made from phenol plus formaldehyde, aminoplast made from urea and or melamine plus formaldehyde or from isocyanates as examples. For food contact, note that isocyanates are made from aliphatic isocyanates as the isocyanate function easily hydrolyzes into amine. It is crucial to avoid formation of aromatic amines for food contact applications. So let's now talk about food contact regulations for metal packaging. So first, why are can coatings regulated? So when a material is put in contact with food, there can be some release or migration of substances from the packaging into the food. The level of migration will depend upon the food type and the processing temperature. And the safety is determined by dietary exposure, toxicology, and level of migration of substance. The risk will then be a combination of exposure and hazard. Exposure will be determined by migration tests, and hazard will be determined by toxicological tests. So let's talk about Europe. The legal situation in Europe for metal packaging coatings is not straightforward. Currently, there are no binding laws for coatings other than the framework regulation, in which Article 3 states that packaging should not endanger human health nor modify organoleptic properties of the packed food. So authorized starting substances are listed on positive lists, like SCF list 0 to 4, or on national legislation like Farenwet Chapter 10 for coatings. The substances can have restriction in total quantity. In that case, we talk about QM, or in migration levels. And then we talk about specific migration limits, SMLs. The global migration limit is also in place at 60 ppm, 60 milligram per kilogram of food. And the test is designed to prove inertness of the material. The simulants for migration testing are chosen depending on the final use of the packaging. Can be, for example, 10% ethanol, 3% acetic acid, rectified vegetable oil. In some extent, the condition used for can coatings are close to the testing condition described in the PIM 10-2011 applicable for plastics, but it differs in some cases. So when we need to have new substances approved, they can be approved through EU dossiers. Nevertheless, EFSA reviews only the substances which can be approved, EFSA reviews only petitions for harmonized food contact materials. So is it not the case for coatings? New substances can be approved only in a European country having a national legislation for coatings, like the Netherlands. So now let's show what is the regulatory situation is in the US. So in the US, the food contact substances are regulated by the FDA, the Food and Drug Administration. Food contact materials are considered as indirect food additives by the FDA, and they are regulated in the 21 CFR part 175 for adhesives and coatings. If a product has all its constituents listed, then only a limit on the TNE, total non-volatile extractable, will apply. The TNE is similar to the global migration in Europe. If a non-exempt new food contact substance is intended to be put on the market and introduced in a coating, it needs to be approved by the FDA first through a food contact notification. The food contact notification, FCN, is a comprehensive safety evaluation related to a highly specific end use. It is a thorough risk assessment process conducted by the FDA that considers all components, oligomers, NIAS, and exposure. The greater is the exposure, the more toxicity information is required to support safety. Exposure is calculated by taking into account the migration of substance from one side and some consumption and food type distribution factors on another side. Once the FDA received a FCN, they can either ask questions, object, or accept it for evaluation. And if they have no questions nor objection, During a period of 120 days, the FCM is considered as approved after that delay after submission. And once effective, a FCM is proprietary and can be used only by the company listed as the manufacturer in the FCM and its customer. So far, we talked about legal compliance. But it is only one of the factors which will affect the acceptability of any substance for food contact. And we, as part of the supply chain, have to respond to our supply chain requirements. The other factors which affect acceptability of a substance are due diligence, product integrity, and customer and consumer confidence. So as our goal at Sherwin-Williams is to provide sustainable can lining solutions that address performance, regulatory compliance, and neutralize stakeholders' concern, and this is achieved via science, efficient messaging, and stakeholder engagement. So as I just said, being compliant is necessary, but can be no longer sufficient. And restricting formulations to only listed materials is called working inside the box. Our strategy has been to work outside the box to discover new raw materials that are not listed in order to achieve epoxy-like performance for our coatings. But for that solutions, we must ensure public acceptance to avoid regrettable substitution. And that is part of the key requirements for any new development. And it's how our process of safety by design was born. Safety by design is a process which ensures that products are developed to stand up to scientific rigor over the long term, all along the process of chemical selection and product development. Adequate tests are carried out in order to ensure to bring to market technologies which have minimal level of regulatory concern now and in the future, and to ensure rapid adoption and longevity. And the results of this process include successful introduction of several new to the market technologies which have quickly gained global regulatory approvals. So all the steps are equally important. So I focus today on the step 6, which is migration analysis. The migration tests are carried out in order to screen the coatings for release of materials of concern. The migration testing will allow the screening of the nature and amount of coating material that can migrate into food. It is an important step to ensure that there is no new migration concerns because of a transformation in the polymerization or in the sterilization process or any interaction with food chemistry. So if necessary, we can look at this down to the part per trillion levels. The requirements of the analytical method and detection limit are adjusted regarding guidelines and the requirements of regulatory bodies, along with risk associated with the chemistry and the toxicological concern of the molecule which is evaluated. So we now go into more details in our process on how to approve a new substance. So to approve a new substance, a list of scientific information will have to be generated. We observe some similarities in the requirement from the main legislation as Europe and FDA. European dossiers like FCN will include requirements for global migration data, specific migration data on the new substance, data on all other migrants, and the focus is made on the new substance on migrants derived from the new substance, which is going to be petitioned. They can be degradation products, reaction products, oligomers, and NIAS, Europe being more interested in oligomers and NIAS than FDA so far. The dossier will though have to include toxicological data on the new substance and on the migrants. And the toxicological data required will depend on the level of exposure. The level of exposure will be calculated from the measured migration and the consumption data. And that will define the list of toxicological tests which will have to be carried out. The tests required are defined according to a tiered approach based on likelihood of toxicological effects depending on exposure. Requirements have a few differences between FDA and Europe, let's say. They have also a lot of similarities. So depending on those requirements, based on the requirements, will derive the analytical limits to reach for the migration test in order to allow a correct selection of the tox data to provide on the corresponding substances. So the previous table applies whatever the nature and origin of the substance. It applies to any migrants from the packaging. So the question is how to allow efficient identification of migrants, including unknowns. And our approach is to gather data on the chemistry of the substance and to do all what we can to convert unknowns into knowns or partially knowns. For that, we envisage possible degradation and reaction mechanism. We try to convert as much as possible non-targeted analysis into targeted analysis or semi-targeted analysis by using specific transition to specific fragmentation, specific mass of expected degradation product or reaction product. And we can have to use several techniques and associate the findings in order to increase confidence, like GCMS, LCMS with high mass accuracy, NMR, GPC. So this can require a lot of work. The experience confirmed that the proper amount of work needs to be carried out to gain certainty and confidence on the results. So I will now give you two examples of studies which we did in the past. So the first example of what Ajanbit said will review the work which was carried out in order to make a new organosol stabilizer to be food contact compliant in Europe. The approval of the dossier took several years and required several sets of data until enough scientific evidence were available in order to ensure safety of the material. So what is behind one listing in the Warenwet? So at the beginning of the story, the issue faced by the formulators when they developed a new PVC coating was that the formula needs to contain a stabilizer in order to avoid polymeric degradation and HCl release, as explained a little bit earlier. And there exist very few non-BPA PVC stabilizers which are listed for food contact. Among them are epoxidized oil, but the issue which is often faced is that they can have high migration levels. So it was needed to develop a new resin without bisphenol A with good performance. And then, in order to be allowed to use it for food contact, we had to petition the SCF, Scientific Committee on Food, for 1 or 2 EFSA for this polymeric stabilizer. A third dossier was built. At that time, the analytical capabilities were as they were. They were limited compared to now. And while the analysis of migrants showed specific migration of starting substances being below the detection limits, the level of oligomers less than 1,000 Dalton was quantified at 9.5%. As not all the oligomers were successfully identified, the totality of oligomers was presumed to contain chlorine, and therefore more information was requested. So we had to evaluate the toxicity of the oligomers, including the chlorinated species, and as well to demonstrate the absence of bioaccumulation by showing that oligomers are hydrolyzed in the stomach in presence of gastric juice. So based on the questions after the first petition, a second petition was initiated, consisting in identifying oligomers in the material, isolate the less than 1,000 Dalton fraction, evaluate the toxicity of these less than 1,000 Dalton fraction, and demonstrate the absence of bioaccumulation in parallel. So here, the approach was to characterize the migrating species below 1,000 Dalton and to compare them with the oligomer fraction of the polymeric additive being below 1,000 Dalton as well. And as it was shown that they were representative, the oligomer fraction and chlorinated fraction were used in a COMET assay for tox testing. Preparative HPLC had been used to prepare enough material for the toxicological test, and in addition, required analytical methods were developed in order to allow to demonstrate that hydrolysis occurred in the gastric juice and in the stomach. So as an achievement, in 2012, EFSA issued a positive opinion which enabled the use of this stabilizer, and ultimately the Dutch G4 positively listed this substance in the Warenwet, which is the legislation for coatings in force in the Netherlands. So as a conclusion, without extensive analysis with a range of analytical techniques, this stabilizer will not have been approved, and it has been key to select the proper techniques adapted to each step of the dossier according to the techniques and tools available, and to convert each question into proposals for experiments. Now, my second case study is more recent, and therefore it used more advanced analytical techniques like LCMS with exact mass, QTOF. Our lab developed a polyester resin based on a monomer already approved in Europe for food contact, but not listed in the FDA 175-300. So after review of the chemical structure, the toxicological data available, and the anticipated final use of the coating, some targeted limits were set up for the new coating in terms of migration levels. So those were determined. The target for the new coating was to get a level of migration below 50 ppb for the sum of the substance and all the reaction products derived from it. And if the coating met the limit, that would allow to build a dossier without needing any further toxicological data than the one which were already available for the food contact substance. So the goal of the analytical study was therefore to identify all the migrants containing the food contact substance, assuming that any remaining non-assigned substance will be considered as food contact substance containing. That is on a worst case principle. That's the general rule we have. If we are not sure, we take the worst case as it stands and see which results it gives. And if the results are too high, then we'll focus on being more realistic. But if the worst case gives good results, so it gives either more certainty. So the process developed for this study was to select first the LCMS method conditions, then select proper samples and proper external standards in order to get the appropriate analytical results, then generate a database of possible substances and process the data. The LCMS method selection. So the injections were chosen to be done on a UPLC QTOF instrument with electrospray ionization, with positive and negative modes, because that technique was the most appropriate considering the chemistry of the food contact substance and also reaction product and oligomers expected. The chromatographic method was adapted in order to have the best compromise between a good separation of all oligomers and to a realistic analytical time. So we ended up with 35 minutes per chromatogram, and the mass parameters and acquisitions were adapted to the interest substances which were studied. The buffer was adjusted to promote the most interesting, most sensitive adducts. In our case, no buffer was added, allowing to focus on the H+, N+, and K+ adducts altogether. So then the second step was to select the samples on the external standard used for the identification and quantification of the food contacts containing substances. So in order to help identifying and quantifying all the food contacts containing oligomers, a coating without the food contact substance was used as a blank. External standard was selected for structure similarities, like similar structure of as an oligomer containing the target monomer, in order to ionize or to be predicted to ionize in the same manner and exhibit chromatographic retention. And then a database was generated by listing around 8,000 theoretically possible reaction products in order to help with the identification of the reaction products and oligomers. Once all data acquired, they were reprocessed. The food contact substance containing oligomers were identified by combining first the ion extracted from the statistical analysis characteristic to the coating containing the food contact substance. By default, they were considered as food contact containing if the identification was not possible. And this was combined with the identification from the theoretical database in order to confirm if the oligomer contains the food contact substance or not. Some fragmentation experiments were studied when several hits corresponded to the same accurate mass in order to reduce the number of identifications, ultimately to one single identification. And this permitted to take into account 79 food contact substances containing oligomers into the final migration calculation. In the 79 oligomers, 44 were identified as food contact substance containing, representing 93% of the signal, and the remaining 35 oligomers, representing 7% of the signal, stayed unknown and were considered as food contact substance containing as a worst case. Then the quantification of food contact substances containing oligomers was done thanks to the standard chosen. The unknowns were quantified the same way, and then consumption factors were applied in order to conclude on the results regarding FTR requirements and to convert the migration into exposure. So as a conclusion on this case study, the FCM file was submitted to the FDA and was approved in 2016, and the substance is now authorized in both Europe and the US, and it allows the same products to be commercialized broadly. So as a general conclusion of this presentation, I would say that evaluation of coatings is an interdisciplinary task. The risk assessment is based both on analytical and toxicological consideration. And to get some insight on the formulation, the chemistry, the processing, and the end use applications is really essential. And given the challenges and complexity, a commitment from the organizations and also some investment into both instrumentation and human expertise is essential. So that concludes my presentation. Thank you for listening, and I'm available to answer questions.
All right, thank you so much, Sarah, and we can move on to the Q&A portion now. So our first question, what is the best plasticizer for the coatings?
Okay, thank you for the question, which is more related to the formulation of the coating than on the regulatory aspect, I think. I won't be able to give a single answer as there exist many coatings for many applications, so maybe we can discuss more in details later, and I may forward your question to the appropriate person within my company.
Okay, yeah, we can follow up online after the talk. So the next question, will the new German regulations win out over the Nestle protocol for migration acceptance?
Can you repeat the question, please?
Sure. Will the new German regulations win out over the Nestle protocol for migration acceptance?
Oh, okay. In this case, we put together German regulation, which is related to regulatory requirements, and Nestle protocol, which is guidance from industry. So I will talk only for myself, but my recommendation will be to take both into account. It's not, as I tried to explain in the presentation, the only requirement. You have to comply, but complied with the regulation can be not sufficient for your customers or customers' customers. So it is, I would say, a company decision to adjust. So legally, the German regulation is first on the requirements for compliance, but then requirements from customers also have strong value. So I hope that answers the question.
All right, and next, which technique would you suggest that we use to identify the higher amount of leachable and extractable substances, HPLC-UV, HPLC-MS, or another?
So I think I understand the higher, I can understand the higher amount of leachable and extractable either by higher amount in number of different species or higher amount in concentration. So I would answer by saying that the choice will depend on which information you have on your leachables and extractable. If you know their nature and you have high concentration, so you don't need extensive sensitivity, you may use HPLC UV, but it's more the need for identification which will first make you choose between HPLC UV and HPLC MS or either other techniques, because it will also depend on what is the chemistry of your leachables and extractable, are they volatile or non-volatile, and we for can coatings very often use LCMS because most of our oligomers are too big to be volatile. But then if you're talking about traces and not identified species between HPLC UV and HPLC MS, for sure HPLC MS will give you more information on the nature of the substances.
Can these tests be used in materials other than cans?
I think the same process can be used for the identification of any unknown substance. And I think from what we see outside of can coating, that many chemical industries face the same issue with identifying unknowns and detecting chemicals at very low level. So the more you can get information on the chemistry and convert non-targeted into targeted or semi-targeted analysis, it will definitely help the analyst.
When will a mimic of human saliva be accepted as the extraction media of choice?
So the question, mixed human saliva with extraction of coating. So I think here the question relates to extraction of the external coating of a can, for example, which will be extracted when the can is drained. So the I can't answer on that part. What I described here in my presentation was a simulation of extraction of the internal coating by the food and how we can simulate or at least represent by slightly overestimating the extraction of the internal coating by the food which will be packed in the can. So when will a mimic of human saliva be accepted? Then I can't answer on that question.
Okay. All right. And do you do the migration test using acid simulant? Do you observe corrosion on the specimen and tests?
So 3% acetic acid simulant is listed in Europe in the PIM 10-2011 as representing extraction by acidic food. The 10-2011 is recommended for or is designed for plastic materials. And as I explained in can coatings, we, without any precise guidelines from the regulations, we used to use the test described in the PIM. 3% acetic acid simulant can indeed lead to corrosion. And I would invite you to look at the guidelines which have been recently recommended by CP, and you can find them on the CP website, which give alternative protocols for can coatings. And indeed, 3% acetic acid can lead to corrosion during the test.
Do you think that there is a need for non-target screening workflows based on high-resolution mass spectrometry and data treatment strategies to characterize unknown potential migrants?
That will be an additional set of information. So for sure, it can be useful. Now, the difficulty with LCMS is the absence of libraries, which makes a non-target screening difficult. But these kind of non-targeted screening workflows based on high-resolution mass spectrometry already exists by GCMS, may not be required to use high resolution mass spectrometry because libraries exist by GCMS. So,
and which are the limitations of targeted approaches for the characterization of migration processes?
So for sure, this process required to have information on the chemistry of the material which is analyzed. So it requires to get some insight of the starting substances of the material.
For the library of 8,000 compounds, were those all possible degradants of just a single substance? Does that mean that you have to make a new library for each substance you want to evaluate? And how many libraries and entries do you have?
So yes, indeed, the library of compounds is related to the starting substance and has to be rebuilt for any new product. And I don't have how many libraries and entries we have. The question is not how many libraries we have, because we have seen of no value so far to combine the libraries together, because even with 8,000 compounds, there are still some molecules which have the same exact mass, and the more species we had, the more substance we will, different substance we will have for the same exact mass. So again, the target is really to be as specific as possible when the library is built.
I saw the mention of ethanol extracts, but are there any thoughts on how to analyze extracts from more challenging simulants, for example, extracts from oils?
My hook will be, and it is, can be a general comment regarding all what I presented, is that there is some value to adjust the work to what is necessary to get the required information, and for sure extract from oils is a challenge, and ethanol has the advantage to be a lot easier to handle, so for sure it will be the first solution. Then for the case it will be inappropriate, then other simulants can be envisaged, but that won't be the first the first choice for sure.
Can you comment on the use of or migration of nanoparticles from coatings into food contents? Are food coatings typically analyzed for potential to emit nanoparticles?
Nanoparticles so far have not been seen as an issue in our food contact coatings. I can talk only for the coatings I know from my company for sure. But the general thinking we have first is that our coatings are usually liquid, and in that case, the nanoparticles may, if they may present from the start, from some raw material will be embedded in the coating. And then I'm not aware of any raw materials that we would use which are considered as nanoparticles.
What are some of the challenges in selecting an analytical method to detect and quantify LMWO's migration from can coating?
So the challenges are mostly to try as much as possible to represent reality and to avoid to be too overestimating, but to at least be at least find migrants at least equal to what would migrate into the food. So it's important to know the end use of the material and to run extraction test or migration test, which will be related to the final use of the material. So like we said earlier, for example, use 3% acetic acid to represent acidic food, as it's suggested in Europe. And but for that, we have good starting point from the regulations.
Do you have any comments on edible films?
Edible films, you would mean films coating which could be eaten. We at Sherwin-Williams produce coatings for metal packaging, so I'm not aware of edible films. I would say just because the metal can be swallowed. But no, it's not. That was a joke. It's not my area of expertise here.
Materials of molecular weight of 1,000 or more are considered not absorbed by the human body. Shouldn't we consider the molecular structure and how prone it is to acid or base hydrolysis?
So if I understood the question correctly, the question is a cutoff at 1,000 Dalton appropriate if the molecule structure can hydrolyze? The 1,000 Dalton cutoff is, I would say, widely accepted, but I'm not aware of on really scientific evidence that it's an exact value, and as far as I know, it's it was chosen as high compared to what should be in reality. So yeah, I think that the question is if oligomers above 1,000 would hydrolyze. I would say if the oligomers are supposed to hydrolyze either in acid or base, a large part will hydrolyze during the extraction protocol. But that's a consideration more for toxicologists and how to assess the cutoff on 1,000.
All right, and this will be the final question. Are we sure that migration tests really represent the reality of canned food?
So we are not sure that migration tests represent the reality of canned food. I would say they are designed to maximize or at least to be higher than the migration into real food. And from the publication I'm aware, usually migration into food is lower and sometimes a lot lower than in food simulants. And that's what we need for a good risk assessment, to have migration, to be sure that migration are higher than there will be in reality in real food.
All right, that's all the time we have. Thank you again, Sarah, for your fascinating presentation, and thank you, participants, for being a great audience. Be sure to check CNEN or CNEN online for information on the next edition of CNEN webinars. Thank you to On24 for technology and production services, and thank you, Waters, for the sponsorship that made this interactive webcast possible. For CNEN webinars, I'm Alexandra Taylor. Goodbye.